Yes, Ron, thank you very much. The one and only Ryan Reaves, back by popular demand on After Hours. So listen, the last time we had you on this program, you were playing for the Las Vegas Golden Knights.
Yeah.
Where have you been since?
Everywhere. Just like, I just can't find a home right now. Hopefully this is home now. So back in the cold, where I'm used to.
All right. Obviously from Vegas to the Rangers. You made a contribution to the Rangers. I think it was Molly Walker of the New York Post who wrote that you helped the Rangers rediscover their flair, but then a healthy scratch for what, 8 of 9? So did you ask for the trade?
I would say it's half the truth. Yeah, I kind of found out something was going on and then found out I wasn't going to be playing. And, you know, obviously I want to extend my career. So there was a discussion. I said, yeah, I think if I'm not going to play, it's time to go. And then I come to find out that it was kind of in the works for the last month almost. So half the truth.
Louie. I mean, Dean Evason was that kind of a player when he played. He loves your game. He's talked highly about you. You step right into this lineup and that's a role you're used to.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's one of my favorite systems I've ever played. It's hunt the D, play physical, just, you know, get the puck out, go hunt. So it's been an easy transition and an unbelievable group of guys down there.
Awesome. So upon acquiring you, General Manager Bill Guerin said he's going to help us with our identity, help us reestablish our identity. So that leads us to this piece of video that went viral last weekend.
Introducing first, starting in the forward position, Joel Eriksson! Oh! Introducing next, starting in the forward position, Marcus!
All right, Ryan, what exactly were you trying to prove there, delivering the starting lineup like that, besides scaring the bejeebers out of your teammates? And we should point out that Sam Steele looked kind of terrified.
Yeah, you know, I did... I did just a regular for the first two. I didn't want to come in too hot with the boys. You know, I got to get to know them a little bit. But I said if we won the first two games when I read, I was going to bring the noise the next one. So, you know, I did the Bruce Buffer.
Awesome. Yeah, you know, he looked terrified, by the way.
I think a couple guys did. I'm not going to lie. Came in a little
too
hot.
Soon, maybe. Too soon.
No. All right, we're good.
All right. Well, as far as new teammates go, Marcus Foligno is one. There is a picture, and we have it here, from a scrap that you had with him on opening night, yeah. October the 13th. At last count, on your Instagram account, it had 54,000 likes, and it got some attention from well-known hockey fan Snoop Dogg. Explain it.
Snoop, he DM'd me a couple days after that picture came out, said he wanted to print some T-shirts. I said, yeah, let's do it. There was a little bit of legality that we had to go through, so it was a little bit delayed. And I got traded to Mini, and I texted one guy from his team, and I said, you know what, I can't do my boy like that. I was actually on his line for a couple games, so I couldn't be walking around with me beating up Big Moose like that.
Well, and you know what? I mean, he is a big kid, right?
That's why they call him Moose.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now, it was a one-sided fight. How did that?
Yeah, we got it here. Let's have
okay, but how did that change the welcome when you walked in? Because listen, when I was with the Tampa Bay Lightning, we acquired Sandy McCarthy, and he absolutely owned me in fights, and I was so happy to see him on my own team. Did you get that kind of response when you walked in the room?
You know what? He texted me right when I got traded, and he said, "I'm glad we're meeting on better terms." And I said, "It was never bad terms." I said, "It's all business."
Lots of respect, right?
Moose is one of those guys. He plays hard. He doesn't play dirty. You know, maybe he got a little high on that hit. That's why we fought. But it's a guy I've always had respect for. So, you know, I feel like I'm going to be hanging out with him most on this team.
Awesome. Good friends, right?
Oh, yeah.
So we talked to Marcus Foligno at the end of the game tonight, and I asked him about being on the same team with you and the safety in that, and here's what he had to say.
Definitely. You know, there's definitely some calmer sleeps before playing that guy. You definitely know that he's on your team now. It's an easier nap routine. So, you know, it is what it is. We're excited to have him. He's just got that presence, that intimidation that, you know, tough guys have. So definitely nice to not have to take some shots off the side of the head because of that guy's not on your team. So, but you know what? He's been a great guy in our room, and guys look up to him. And, you know, also he's been on a lot of teams that have had a lot of experience in the playoffs, and you know, that's what we need in this room. So it's been a great addition for our team.
And talking
the
about
tear to my eye.
I know.
Yeah. So many nice words.
Talking about the room, this picture from the Edmonton room the other night where you played. Is it a coincidence that he's in the stall next to you?
We've been next to each other almost every game. It's definitely not a coincidence that the shirt's off, though. This is how we sell the game right here, Scotty.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You keep the suit on, I take the shirt off.
Two people in the world that shouldn't have their shirts off, and that's you and Darcy Oak. Who
me?
For the ink.
Scotty, we've been over this. I've been in your hot tub. You know what I look like. You see the shots right there.
Yeah,
come on.
Okay, good. Yeah. All right, on the topic of fighting, it is part of your game. But the fact is you haven't had that many in recent years, so let's have a look at the decline in numbers. 56 scraps in 6-plus seasons with the Blues, 6 in 1 year in Pittsburgh, 6 in Vegas, 3 last year with the Rangers, and only 2 this year. Is this all a case of the invitations to go all but drying up?
Yeah, a little bit. I think there's less takers. Maybe my reputation precedes me a little bit, but there's just a little less toughness in the league right now. I think it's going to come back. I'm telling you, I've been saying this for years. It's going to slowly start coming back when, somebody like me is going to catch, maybe not McDavid, he's a little fast for me, but somebody's going to catch one of those guys, and then they're going to need some backup, and it's going to start coming back.
Well, you've morphed into what the tough guy is of today, too, and it's a guy that you're not just going out there and fighting. I agree with you. I think the game has changed where it'd be tough for you to find fights in some nights. Guys don't want to drop the gloves with you, but you have to be able to skate. You're always up amongst the leaders in hits. You're doing your part that way in the forecheck. We saw what you do in the room, so you have to bring that to the table as well in that role, but I agree with you. I do think tough guys find a way to continue carving out that niche for
coming
themselves.
Coming back, I'm telling you.
Yeah.
You are a leading NHL heavyweight, but you got to pick your spot. Give us an example of turning down an invitation.
Oh, man. I think, if you're up by 3-4 goals and, somebody just says, let's go for no reason, he hasn't done anything. My thing is if somebody wants to fight, either you're going to come after me because I've laid somebody out, or you're going to go do something, hit somebody, and I'm going to come after you. I don't, these stage fights are kind of leaving the game.
Do you really turn down fights, though?
Yeah.
I try not to.
I was going to say,
Here's a question from Alberta. Are you looking forward to retirement so that you can take on Biz Nasty during one of those rough and rowdy pay-per-views?
It's the only thing I'm looking forward to in retirement. I'm not going to lie. I'm going to whoop him up and down that ring. But, I'm not looking forward to retirement yet. I don't know what I'm going to do after.
Well, we should say that Biz Nasty is Paul Bissonnette of Spit and Chicklets fame, the podcast, and he also works as a commentator.
And you hear it again, Biz. There's the invitation again. You've had it once.
Well,
here's twice.
Well, speaking of retirement, now listen, Scott likes to claim that he got Kevin Bieksa to the panel in Toronto because he had him on this show many times. I think you've taken over for Kevin. You're really close for times on. Would broadcasting maybe be something you want to do?
I've thought about it. It's crossed my mind. Broadcasting, coaching, management. I don't think I can leave hockey for sure. I don't think I can just go out and do something completely outside of hockey. So, but broadcasting has definitely crossed my mind. Yeah. I have fun with it,
Yeah, absolutely. Hey, you're good at talking.
You grew up watching me on TV, and that's all we have to say. earlier, we saw the high-intensity delivery of the starting lineup, and it's interesting to note that you can go from that to this.
The message coming from a predominantly white league has a lot bigger impact. Not bigger impact, but it has a very strong impact when it's coming from players like this. Most of these guys have never lived through some of the stuff that black athletes have. They don't go through those day-to-day things that they feel that racism, or they've seen the racism, or their family's gone through it. But for them to say, look, we see what's going on in society, and we disagree with it, and something has to change right now.
So, there you were, an eloquent spokesman for all the players in the playoff bubble in Edmonton a couple of years ago. You led them in their protest against systemic racism, the protest spurred by the shooting of Jacob Blake in Kenosha, Wisconsin. How do you look back on your role in that protest?
I think I was kind of thrown to the forefront. I think I had a lot of support from a lot of players. It wasn't just me kind of leading that. I was nicely surprised that when the discussion started. The discussion was already being had, you know, in the East bubble. They contacted me, you know, the guys from Vancouver. They want, we were playing them. They wanted to come talk to me. Yeah. So it wasn't, you know, it wasn't just me. I think I helped lead a little bit with, you know, many other players. But, you know, hats off to every player in that bubble that, you know, that took a stand and, you know, and did something with it.
You said at the time the statement being made today has to last. Has it?
Yeah, I think we're taking steps. You know, the world's a messy place right now. I think, you know, there's one issue that comes up and then, you know, it slows down a little bit and then we find ourselves in another issue and, you know, and then we have to talk about those. But, you know, North America is a messy place right now and there's a lot of hate that that needs to stop.
Dakota Joshua, the Canucks, is going to join us here in our next segment. His brother Jagger is a senior at Michigan State, and he had to endure some racial slurs in a game last month. What do you think when you hear that stuff happening today?
It's heartbreaking. You know, I don't understand why, you know, the color of somebody's skin or the background or, you know, their sexual preference or, you know, what they do in their life. I don't know why that's anybody else's business but that person. And, you know, to attack somebody for that is... You know, it's heartbreaking. It's disgusting. You know, there's no room for it. Not only in sports, but just in general. It's just it's unnecessary. And I don't know. You know, I've never claimed to have the answer to how to change that. It's a hard subject to say. Yeah, here's the answer. But you know, little things every day, every month, every year that you know you can do to you know push towards that is very important.
Now we got to try to turn the corner. I don't know how we're going to do it, but. Back to you. Just a couple of minutes left, and so we have to address the Wilds' brief stay at Kananaskis Village, the highlight of which was the amazing race. It was teams of four in 14 station challenges. Yu Zuccarello, Patan, Camarosa won it, at least you claim to. I don't know what kind of tactics these are in any kind of race, but are you prepared on network TV to say your win was legitimate?
Absolutely. Listen, we walked in first, okay? The rules were stated that you cannot leave your team. You have to stay as a team. And I saw Matt Dumba, you know, I said his name already. I saw Matt Dumba.
Yeah.
He was by himself a couple times, so there was a little bit of controversy. But you know what? The trophy was a little was basically a little cup that we won. So it goes around the room.
Listen, you know, part of that was outside and you I would think have an unfair advantage because of those size 14 feet. Should they not function as snowshoes?
Scotty, do you understand? We clocked it. We ran almost 8 miles or 8 kilometers. Somebody clocked. Do you know how hard it is to run through snow in size 14 Timberlands for that long at 35 years old? I pulled two hammies. My calves were gone. Like my goodness.
But isn't it incredible how competitive you get for a game like that?
We were buzzing
it's
the whole
unbelievable.
Time.
Oh like my you goodness. See you
we
guys
wanted
rest.
That
you
one.
Wanted to win.
Oh
right?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
That's great. I love those things that bring you together. And then the competition comes out and everybody. And
it was so
it's
much
a bonding
fun, yeah.
thing. Right?
And it was good for me to be there, you know, at that time when I just got traded because it was, you know, a little friendly competition. Have a couple beers. It's a good time.
Good. Well, listen, finally, Ryan, any interview that we do with you has to end with this clip. We've shown it before, but it's gold.
Am I singing?
No.
Oh.
That's fresh.
It is fresh.
Fresh. Ooh. You a bad man. You a bad, bad man. You bad man.
Okay, listen, from...
Scotty, listen, you know every... You know every what?
Wait now. Let's go to the pictures, Paul, that we have. How do you go from this to being a bad, bad man? How does that happen?
Hey, just growing up with your son, I have to be a bad man. I have to protect him every day of my life.
That's you and Darcy. And by the way, Darcy was the best man at your wedding.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah,
he was. That's about the only picture we could take of the house that day, too.
There you go.
Scotty, you know we have to end every interview like this, though. Come on now. Oh, yeah, yeah. Hey, hold on. We got a couple pics of, of my own.
Let's see them.
Let's bring those up. Who's that guy?
Oh, there you go.
That's that's my evil twin. That would have been, I think, back in late 70s in at CBC Manitoba.
Scotty, you had some nice hair.
Wow.
I've seen that head of hair in Halloween City for Halloween. Sell that wig.
Yeah, that haircut actually exists, but not in this solar system.
Who was cutting your hair back then?
I don't
know. And who was letting you out of the house like that?
Right off the Anchorman set.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. You look good, though, Scott.
Nice of you to say, even if you don't really mean it.
Ryan, I do mean it.
Thanks for coming on again. It's good to see you.
Scott.
All right. You too.
All
right. And that's bad journalism right there, but it's good to have you on the program. All right, Ryan Reaves, now a member of the Minnesota Wild and a regular guest in After Hours. When we return to Rogers Arena, Dakota Joshua of the Canucks will join us as After Hours continues.